yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
During World War II, patriotic feelings were strong all across America. Everyone wanted to help their country, no matter their age, sex, or race. Despite this widespread eagerness by Americans to fight for their country, the U.S. military placed barriers in the way of certain groups. One of those groups was African Americans. Their units were segregated and given non-combat support roles.
All the units that were manned by blacks were service units, like truck drivers and cooks and supply people, and were all essentially in the rear of the lines and weren't doing any fighting.
Certain members of the white military establishment assumed that blacks were incapable of complex technical tasks. This belief was a reflection of attitudes prevalent in mainstream white America at the time.
So we weren't expected to go to college. So there was a high emphasis on the trades of printing and mechanics and bricklaying and that type of thing.
It was under this backdrop of racism that black civil rights and other groups pressured the military to allow blacks into more technical roles. In December 1940, the Army Air Corps submitted a plan to the War Department to conduct what they called an experiment. They suggested forming an all-African-American squadron. A month later, in January 1941, the 99th Pursuit Squadron was created at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama.
So they started this experimental program down at Tuskegee, and it was really an experiment that was designed for failure. The idea was, we'll start it down there, but it will just be a few people going through, and it will never, the individuals involved in it will never be utilized in fighting this war.
This Tuskegee experiment, as it became known, was a uniquely important event in American history. It was a chance for certain whites in the military to prove once and for all their beliefs that blacks are incapable of the skills it takes to be a military pilot. For the African-American trainees sent to Tuskegee, it would be their chance to prove the exact opposite. If they succeeded at Tuskegee, they could make a statement about themselves and for all African-Americans. When the base opened in 1941, many young African-Americans became interested in training at Tuskegee. Never before had blacks been allowed the opportunity to serve their country in this way, by piloting some of the most advanced aircraft of their time. Coloradan John Mosley was one of those young African-Americans who set his sights on flight training at Tuskegee. He was a student at Colorado A&M, now known as Colorado State University. Like many of his classmates, he wanted to graduate, join the military, and fight for his country. Getting a chance to train at Tuskegee became a primary focus in his life. But as he would learn, just getting to Tuskegee would be half the battle. John Mosley was born in East Denver in the 1920s, at a time when the Ku Klux Klan was still very active.
The church was at Park Lane and Washington. The Ku Klux Klan, as I understand it, set fire to that church and burned it down. And I remember when I ran all the way from my house, which was 2456 Marion Street, up there to see the church burned down. And we later rebuilt the church on that in that same area.
Growing up with prejudice all around him, John needed to be strong to succeed in life. His strength came from his close-knit family. This was his foundation. It gave him the strength of character to persevere in life, no matter what the challenges. John's success started early in life. He graduated valedictorian from Manual High School. That success continued at college, where he was a wrestling champion, on the student council, and selected for who's who in American universities and colleges. He also proved that he was not afraid to break racial boundaries. At Colorado A&M, he became the first black to play football in what was called the Big Seven Conference.
Naturally, as you go through those kinds of experiences, you recognize that you can't convince everybody. So you just try to establish a relationship with one or two fellows, and essentially those were the fellows that were the leaders on the team.
As successful as John was during his college years, World War II was raging on, and his goal of fighting for his country as a pilot became increasingly important. But he ran into obstacles at every turn. To get to Tuskegee, it would be important for John to go through advanced ROTC in college. To do that, he would first need to pass a physical.
And so I came down to Fitzsimmons and was given a physical examination and went back up and was waiting to be called that in September, or to be designated anyway as an advanced ROTC student, and found out that I wasn't selected. And of course, I questioned them on why, and they said, well, you weren't physically qualified.
John Mosley, the star wrestler, star football player, failed his physical. But John wasn't a quitter. Despite the odds, he was determined to become a pilot. He paid for and easily passed a much tougher flight physical and learned to fly through the civilian pilot training program. After graduation from college, John was certain he'd be called up for training at Tuskegee. He was a star athlete, a scholar, and a pilot. Again, he ran into barriers.
I thought that when I graduated in June, that I would be called immediately to go down to Tuskegee to start my flight training down there. And so 1 month rolled on, and then 2 months, and then finally, I think in September, I hadn't been called, so I went down to the draft board and asked them, when would I be called up to go to Tuskegee? And they were very surprised that, and looked in their little folder there and said, I thought that you were already called up. And so immediately they took action and moved my card index to be called up. And so within a week, I was issued a notice to report to Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And Fort Sill, Oklahoma was the place that we trained all of our people for field artillery.
After all his hard work to get into Tuskegee, it seemed the door of opportunity was once more closing on him. But even after being sent to artillery school, John remained determined. Tuskegee was the only option. He would not let go of his dream.
I immediately start writing the governor, and my family got involved with the contacting our congresspeople and asking the question that I had been asking, why am I not a cadet down at, aviation cadet at Tuskegee? And so after about 2 months of training in field artillery at Fort Sill, I was called down first. It went to Keesler Air Force Base, and which was a sort of reception center for those going to Tuskegee, and finally got down to Tuskegee.
And once he arrived, he faced many more challenges. There were the long days of rigorous flight training, and worse, he faced many white officers who wanted to see the Tuskegee experiment fail. Trainees like John, who had a good chance at succeeding at Tuskegee on their own merits, were targeted by white trainers to be dropped from the program for seemingly any reason.
And I observed very rapidly that if you displayed that kind of knowledge to your instructors, that they would find some way to wash you out, as we call it, to be washed out.
John learned quickly to be silent about the aviation skills he had brought with him. To make it through Tuskegee, he was forced to play a role that allowed his white instructors to believe that all his skills were the result of their training.
It was very embarrassing to have to assume that role of being less qualified and less experienced in order to get your wings.
Faced with tough training as well as racism, John persevered at Tuskegee and went on to become a pilot. As a whole, the Tuskegee Airmen were outstanding in combat. They had a perfect bomber escort record, never losing a single bomber to enemy planes in 200 missions. When World War II ended, John Mosley elected to leave the Army Air Corps. As hard as he had worked to become a pilot, the segregated nature of the military had left a bitter taste in his mouth. He returned to Denver and stayed active in aviation. While working on his master's degree at the University of Denver, he trained pilots at Lowry and also started an aviation club called the Swoop Club. This club was meant to encourage young African Americans to consider careers in aviation. In 1948, President Truman issued Executive Order No. 9981, desegregating the entire U.S. military. That event, as well as the conflict in Korea, eventually brought John back into the military and the newly created U.S. Air Force. He continued his service for over two decades and retired as a lieutenant colonel in 1970. The story of John Mosley's courage and determination to both make it to and make it through Tuskegee is far more than a piece of history, beginning with the Swoop Club he had formed after World War II and continuing on with his own son. He has given new generations of African Americans a chance to dream of flying. John's son, Eric Mosley, went on with his own career in the Air Force and then became a captain with United Airlines. Both John and Eric Mosley are also launching careers in aviation for a whole new generation. They started the Mile High Flight program that serves much the same purpose as did John's Swoop Club after World War II.
The thought was that we as blacks had little opportunity for role models and for people to assist us in getting interested in flying. So we work with youngsters at the high school level.
It exposes young African Americans and young people of all races to the world of aviation, giving them opportunities they might not otherwise have.
The most rewarding feeling I've ever had, the most I felt like I was on top of the world, I had accomplished my dream. Even though I wasn't there yet, I had taken a very large step in when I soloed for the first time. But since then, it's every time I get in the airplane, I have to stop and think, you know, where I'm at. I mean, I'm flying my own airplane. I'm in charge. There's 360 degrees that I could go in, and it, you know, the sky's open, the sky's the limit. And it's the most rewarding feeling, and just a steam builder. I mean, confidence, I'm bubbling with confidence when I'm up there.
John Mosley's story has a message for all of us. Each and every one of us face our own Tuskegee at some time in our life. It's represented by the challenges and opportunities we face. How we meet and overcome those challenges reveals our human spirit.
So if I speak to youth groups, I always tell them that don't accept failure as being the end to anything that they want to do. If they tried something and they weren't successful, to come back and go at it and try it again, or at some other aspect of this. So as black and as certainly as a minority, you have to continue to fight, as we say. And I often say, I have to fight to be able to fight. And the fight has never ended. You got to continue to excel in anything that you do.
John Mosley's story and the story of the Tuskegee Airmen is ultimately a story of the triumph of the human spirit, the spirit that reaches out to all people of all races, of all generations, a spirit that whispers to us, have faith in yourself, never give up, hold on to your dreams.
All our lives. as we thought. There are mountains in our way, but we climb a step every day.